Hare Krishna, reading from Bhagavad Gita as it is, chapter 2, text 52. Yadate moha kalilam buddhirvyate tarishyate tada gantasi nirvedam shrotavyasya shrutasya cha. When your intelligence has passed out of the dense forest of delusion, you shall become indifferent to all that has been heard and all that is to be heard. So Krishna is continuing his instructions to Arjuna. There are many good examples in the lives of the great devotees of the Lord, of those who became indifferent to the rituals of the Vedas simply by devotional service to the Lord. When a person factually understands Krishna and his relationship with Krishna, he naturally becomes completely indifferent to the rituals of fruitive activities, even though an experienced Brahmana. So why is it said rituals of the Vedas become indifferent to the rituals of the Vedas? Because a devotee means when a person factually understands Krishna as a fact, who is Krishna, what is his position, not what I think Krishna should be, or not what I think Krishna must be like this. No. When a person understands who Krishna is actually, to whatever degree then, because we are limited, we cannot understand Krishna completely, but when we can understand Krishna's position as the Supreme Lord, and when a person can understand his relationship with Krishna. So when we can understand, oh, Krishna is the Supreme Lord, and I am an eternal servant of Krishna, then what happens? Then he naturally becomes completely indifferent to the rituals of fruitive activities. Then he knows, oh, I'm not the body. I'm the soul. I'm an eternal servant of Krishna. Why should I work in a way that I want to enjoy the results? Let me work for the pleasure of Krishna. And this stage is achieved by devotional service, by engaging in devotional service, which begins by hearing and chanting. So the more we hear and chant, the more we will be able to understand the position of Krishna and our position and our relationship with him. Then we will know how to act so that we get freed from karma. Sri Madhavendra Puri, a great devotee and acharya in the line of the devotees, says, Sandhya Vandana Badramastu Bhavato Bosnana Tubhyam Namo Bo Deva Pitarascha Tarpana Vidau Naham Shamaha Shamyatam Yatra Kwapi Nishadya Yadava Kulotam Masasya Kamsadvishaha Smaram Smaram Agham Agham Harami Tad Alam Manye Kim Anye Name. Oh, my prayers three times a day, all glory to you. O bathing, I offer my obeisances unto you, O demigods, O forefathers. Please excuse me for my inability to offer you my respects. Now, wherever I sit, I can remember the great descendant of the Yadu dynasty, Krishna, the enemy of Kamsa, and thereby I can free myself from all sinful bondage. I think this is sufficient for me. So Madhavendra Puri, he is a great acharya in our life. And what is he saying? That just by thinking of Krishna, just by thinking of Krishna, we can get free from sinful reactions because Krishna is pure. He's all pure. So it's like bathing. When we come in touch with water, if we are dirty, automatically the dirt will go away. No? So when we are in association with Krishna, how do we associate with him? By speaking about him, by remembering him, by hearing about him, what's happening? Then our sinful reactions are being gone. They are being cleared off. The material desires are being washed off. And so Madhavendra Puri is saying that it's sufficient for him to engage in bhakti. He does not need to do the Vedic rituals of going to special places just to take a bath, or offering different rituals to the different demigods or to the Pitra. the same time that he would do that, in that time, he is engaging in bhakti. So what is he doing then? He's getting rid of all the sinful reactions himself. And in fact, he is doing the best service, that the demigods are happy with him, the forefathers are happy with him, the places of pilgrimages are happy with him, the Vedas are happy with him, everyone is happy with him. The demigods do not want us to separately pray to them. They don't want us. They want us to pray to Krishna. And if we do that, they're happy. The forefathers, we can give them the highest benefit if we become a devotee of Krishna. That's the best help we can give to the forefathers. If we become a devotee of Krishna, their souls will get liberated if we become a very pure devotee. So the Vedic rites and rituals are imperative for neophytes. Comprehending all kinds of prayer 3 times a day, taking a bath early in the morning, offering respects to the forefathers, etc. But when one is fully in Krishna consciousness and is engaged in his transcendental loving service, one becomes indifferent to all these regulative principles because he has already attained perfection. So there is nothing higher than bhakti. All we have to do is engage in bhakti, perform the activities of Krishna consciousness. Hearing, chanting, remembering Krishna, worshipping the deity. That's all that there is. And that is perfection. If one can reach the platform of understanding by service to the Supreme Lord Krishna, he has no longer to execute different types of penances and sacrifices as recommended in revealed scriptures. So one who's taking the direct path of bhakti, of devotional service, does not need to separately do any yajna, tapasya, or some prayaschit, or, you know, they don't need to do that. Just take up bhakti yoga. And similarly, if one has not understood that the purpose of the Vedas is to reach Krishna and simply engage in the rituals, etc., then he is uselessly wasting time in such engagements. So if a person, he is studying the Vedas, he's performing the rituals, but he's not able to understand that everything is for what? Is to come to the point of worshipping Krishna, is to understand that Krishna is the Supreme Lord and that I'm his eternal servant. So let me engage in glorifying him. So if a person, by following the Vedas, by doing the rituals, by doing the prayaschit, by doing the yajna, tapasya, if one is not coming to this point, means he's just wasting his time. Because the purpose of the Vedas is to come to the point that Krishna is the Supreme Lord, I am his eternal servant, and I need to engage in his transcendental loving service. Persons in Krishna consciousness transcend the limit of Shabda Brahma or the range of the Vedas. Bhakti yoga, when one is engaging in bhakti yoga, means he has understood all the Vedas. Vedas cha sarve aham eva vedya. That's what Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita 15 chapter, that by all the Vedas I am to be known. He says that what is the reason that all these Vedas exist? For us to come to the point of Krishna, to understand his position. That's the purpose. And so once we understand Krishna's position and our relationship with him, then that is the perfection. And all begins by hearing and chanting about Krishna. Hearing and chanting. It begins by hearing and chanting. That's the means and that's the goal. Bhakti is the process and it's the goal. A devotee hears and chants, and after liberation he continues to hear and chant because it's Krishna, he's associating with Krishna. Is that okay?
Yeah, everything's okay. Nice explanation.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you. So we'll stop here for today. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Shila Prabhupada ki jai, Gaur Premande Hari.